Hello friends, happy Tuesday. Oh my gosh, it seems like it's been so long since I've talked to you guys. I've missed you, but you know, a lot has happened since I think the last video. What did we do in the last video? I can't even remember. But anyway, today we are due to talk about civility in the workplace. Well, you know, we had a little bit of a scare with Dorian, the hurricane, so I think everybody was a little bit stressed out. We were, you know, we were grateful that we didn't get hit. But of course, we all want to pray for our friends in the Bahamas. Oh, God. The pictures and videos are heartbreaking. But you know, there is a disaster or more going on everywhere, you know, some part of the world. So we just take one day at a time, because I remember the saying, someone would say, there by the grace of God go I, it would be me. So we have to always be cognizant that life is measured in moments and minutes. Nothing is guaranteed. Disaster, trauma, anything can happen. So we kind of have to be ready and make every moment count, correct? All right, the first video we did on civility was, we gave you the dictionary definition that it means it's a certain way you carry yourself. And it had a civic undertone, which means it was the government, it was society that expected us to, you know, act politely, taking into consideration someone else being, you know, you take into consideration who they are, their history, and treating everybody with respect. And we were lamenting how we have lost a lot of that in the public square in America, where, especially now with social media. I was reading something last night from school about netiquette, talking about the etiquette that you have online. And gosh, we should all have those in mind as we deal with folks on a daily basis. But I wanted to translate that into the workplace, because as you know, most of you know, there is a lot going on. And it is true that, you know, when you look at literature, music, it's just a reflection of our current society, our current state of being. So if we have incivility in our lives, in online, talking to friends, you know, we have friends who don't talk to each other anymore, we have family members who are estranged because of the political environment, it translates into the workplace, right? Because we are dealing with people. People are the same whether they are, you know, from north, south, east, west, European, whatever. People are people. So we tend to, what's the word I'm looking for? We tend to embrace and show what is happening in our environment by our speech and by the way we carry ourselves and by the way we interact with people, right? So what I wanted to say is that what we have noticed in the workplace is those same tenets of incivility. For example, when you are at work, you should know what the expectations are, right? So you have a job description, you sign that you're gonna be able to carry 40 pounds, you're gonna be able to have good interpersonal skills. But in reality, when you get to the nitty-gritty or the day-to-day, it translates into who you are. And I said that last in the last video. As a supervisor, as a manager, I can teach you how to use the electronic record that we use. I can show you the processes of how we do things. But seriously, I cannot teach you how to talk to people. I cannot teach you how to deal with a difficult family member. Those things, I think a lot of it is upbringing and a lot of it is self-trained, self-taught. Now, if you're not somebody who is got some introspection and you're not true to yourself where you could say, you know what, I need to work on these and these in my character, in my personality. But if you think everything is cool with you, then there is no room for improvement. So in terms of civility, let's talk about respect, for example. Respecting your direct manager, respecting the management team, the structure, knowing, and I had to tell some of the staff this past weekend, this girl had an issue with her payroll, and then somebody said, well, no, go to the administrator. And I'm gonna hold up. This is not the chain of command. You don't take a payroll issue straight up to the administrator. You have your scheduler, you have your supervisor, you have your unit manager, you have your director of nursing, you have HR. So there are steps. And knowing how to navigate those steps shows that you're somebody who respects authority and you respect the structure, okay? Because as I said also, we cannot live in chaos. You have to have order, okay? So, respecting the authority. The other thing is respecting each other. Oh my gosh, how you talk to, I have some people I work with, frankly, when they talk to me, sometimes I have to kind of bring them back. I said, you have got to watch your tone. And I have to tell some of the employees that. It's like, when you come to me with an issue, you come for me to kind of help you out. We're going to strategize together as to how we can solve the problem. But don't come to me like you're attacking me. Okay, that's why it's important for you, if you are upset, and this is something I practice in my own personal life, when you are upset, even when I had kids, do not handle the situation immediately. You need to step back, get away, step away from the situation, give yourself some time to reflect and cool down. Because when you do that, then probably you're going to handle the situation a different way, okay? So when you are dealing with co-workers or with your immediate supervisor, whatever the situation, and you know what, I don't really care what the problem is, whether they were unfair to you, they messed up your schedule, they don't give you enough time off, they denied your time off request, it doesn't matter, okay? You have got to know how you're going to approach that person. So think about that and practice that. Take some time to cool off. Count to 10. You've heard people tell you that. Take some deep breath. Step away. Go outside. Guys, this is self-preservation. You don't want to enter a situation in a violent mood. And I always told my kids, there are a lot of people sitting in jail now serving a life sentence because of a snap decision. They did not take those 5 minutes away, go cool off before you address the situation. Whatever, somebody insults you, somebody, whatever they did to you, if you just take that time to reflect, you are going to, keep yourself out of trouble. So respect for others. How you talk to your coworkers. It's never a good idea to attack somebody's character. You may not agree with how they carry themselves. You may not agree with their lifestyle. You may not agree with how they perform their job. But yet, you are still expected to show respect to that person. I treat my CNAs exactly the same way I treat my nurses and my managers, is please and thank you. Respect, it's so important to do that. The other point that I want to bring, how about respect for the public, your customers? Oh my God, if you work in healthcare, I mean, you know, I don't think healthcare is that different from any other business. Your customer, now I happen to be one person who doesn't believe that the customer is always right. I never ascribe to that line because sometimes customers are dead wrong. And I'm not ever going to let my employee, my staff feel that I'm always going to take the resident or the customer's side. No, you know, I am there to provide a service. I am there to provide excellent customer service. But that doesn't mean I'm going to say, oh, well, yeah, they don't ever do anything wrong. We know better than that, don't we? All right, so in long-term care, which I'm working in, I work in home care for a long time, and we had issues in home care, but long-term care is a whole different animal, guys. I firmly believe that a lot of family members put their families in those nursing homes looking for something to go wrong so they can, you know, take some steps. You know what I mean, right? Okay. So we have to be on our P's and Q's. You have the ombudsman, people complain, and then you have a certain law firm that constantly on. I mean, I can't get away from them. They're in the car, they're on the billboard, they're on the radio. Oh my gosh. It's like if your family has a little red nest, call, and then, you know, the companies end up, you know, settling out of court with these companies. And in fact, someone told me they build their budget on knowing that probably the majority of their claims are going to be settled out of court. So we ought to do the best we can. And I tell the employees, when you complain that you're not getting a raise, it's because this industry is involved in such litigious scenarios, people suing them left and right, that really is difficult. Plus, the reimbursement is not that great. Now, having owned the business, I understand that, but most employees don't understand that. So, in trying to keep our job, you may not understand that keeping families happy is part of your job, but it is. You don't want to give family members or the patient a reason to be unhappy to file a claim. All right? That doesn't mean you let them walk all over you. We all know that whenever something happens to the patient, it's like, you know, big drama. But to us, you know, you can still walk around, you breathing, you're okay. I know it sounds kind of cynical, but you know, when you've been in this business for a little bit, you become cynical. So, talking to the family members, the please and thank you. When you go into somebody's room, make sure you knock. And that's not just personal. That is the requirement from your job. And addressing people with Mr. and Mrs., that's civility. If the patient said, call me Annie, then they've given you permission. But until you get permission, you do not address a patient by their name. That's a lack of respect. And then when you're talking to your manager, know how you're going to talk to your manager. You can knock on their door. You can say, I would like to speak to you. You don't just burst into their office and demanding their time. They have multiple stuff going on. They do not have to stop what they're doing to talk to you right then. Okay? You know, I always tell, they come and they're storming out of the patient's room and they come. I'm talking on the phone with a family member and like their body language and say, I need to talk to you now. And my body language says, you're going to have to wait a few minutes because I'm busy right now, okay? So you do not let somebody infringe on in your space, on your time, because they're demanding your attention. They need to know how to approach you and wait. So when you're talking to the patient, Mr. Mrs., I tell the other day I was doing a little intro for the CNAs about customer service, and I said, when you are talking to a patient and they put their light on and you go in there, what do you need? That is not civility. That is not good customer service. How may I help you? Yes, I know they're on the line all the time. I do know. It wears on your nerves. It wears on your mentation. I get it. But you have got to be committed to this process. This is how I'm going to interact with my customers. Because, you know, if you think of a patient as a customer, you know, I think maybe 10, 15 years ago, we went into this, patients were customers, you know, it was all the rage, but now we're back to patient and resident, which is fine. You know, it's like what goes around comes around. I'm okay with it. But how you enter somebody's room, they'll know whether you're in a frame of mind to help them or not. And some of them, you know, tell me they kind of get scared when somebody, let's say you have a frail little 102-pound, you know, little patient, and you have this person who weighs over 200 pounds and they're saying, what do you need? You know, that's intimidating, okay? And I can tell people, think about it. It could be your mom, it could be your auntie, it could be your grandma. But I know, it's a long shot. And when I say that, they kind of roll their eyes. But this is all about civility. How you talk to the patient, how you touch the patient, how you, well, we're threading onto the abuse part, which is not what we need to do. So, how you talk to the patient and the family. And of course, we have those family members who are just, oh my God, they are a handful. And I find that a lot of time it's anxiety. We had a resident the other day who just came in, but the daughter looked like a little type A, hyper person anyway. But then as I started talking to her, she was telling me, oh, my husband's in the hospital too. Now my dad, that's overwhelming. So sometimes their attitude, the way they react, they come across as complainers, but you got to do a little psychology 101. And I think it doesn't come easy or natural to a lot of people to understand that that's probably what's going on. They're probably just anxious, all right? So civility to your management team, civility to each other, civility meaning respect and professional demeanor, and civility towards your patients, your resident, who are your customers. And you know, there's another thing about customers. We say that we, or our employees, are also our customers. Because if we think about it and we want to treat them with respect, if we think of customers. Now, when you think of customers, you're thinking of somebody who you're trying to sell something to, right? You have a service, you have a product, and they want to buy it. If you keep that mindset in relation to your patient, it's going to kind of change your attitude of how you deal with them. Because believe it or not, they pay your paycheck. They're the ones with the patients being in that bed. That's how you get paid. And I don't think a lot of people understand that. I have staff members saying, oh, it's Saturday, we shouldn't be getting admissions. And I'm saying, we need people in those beds. That's how we meet the budget. That's how you get paid. Sometimes it's like, over their head. But anyway, I try to do my part. So guys, this is what I wanted to tell you today, to think of your patients as a customer. Think of that family member as a customer and practice civility. And again, remember what I said last time, it takes 3 weeks. I keep showing four fingers, but 3 weeks to develop a good habit. Please, thank you, time out, step back. Don't overreact, don't react in the situation, and think through how you're going to handle it. And let me tell you, it's going to make a huge difference. And it's going to translate not just into your work, but in your personal relationships with your kids, with your, you know, your honey, you know, your mates, your parents. You know, civility is something that we should aspire to practice in our daily life. So this is what I had for you today. I'm on my way, I'm driving. So, you know, I kind of like doing this when I'm driving because I don't have the radio on and I can give you my full attention. So I like that. All right, guys, this is it. I hope you have a wonderful rest of the week. God bless you. I love you. Au revoir. À la prochaine.